real pros.
Oh, absolutely. If we start a couple minutes late,
yeah,
you still have your full time.
Okay.
You know, we just shorten the break a little
okay.
bit, or shorten the lunch break by a minute or two, or, you know.
Excellent. So you have all your time.
We're gonna kick the day off with Niel Freer. How many of you know Niel? Oh, not too many hands. All right, well, you guys are in for a really, really big treat here. I'm sorry. All right. Good morning and welcome. We're gonna kick the day off here with Niel Freer, okay? I'll just tell you a few things about Niel, all right? Wisdom, okay? Wisdom. Wisdom oozes out of Niel Freer. Yeah. Brilliant mind. Big heart. The future. Who are we? Did we come from and where are we going? Niel is truly one of us, okay? When Niel was 6 years old, he had his first contact experience. He was tapped on the shoulder at 6 years old. At 12 years old, he moved up to his lifelong handlers, okay? The Anunnaki. Now, Niel is not here today to talk to us as a contactee. Although to us and to our group, he fully acknowledges that. And you see, all of the wisdom and wonder that oozes out of Niel Freer has a foundation, the Anunnaki. We're in for change, folks, big change. It is coming. It is imminent. And Niel is here to share that with us and to shed a little bit of light onto the journey ahead and maybe give us some road markers and some signposts. Okay? It's going to be a ride. Here's Niel Freer.
So I think I can be at least coherent. And Cicero said that if you're going to give a good talk, that you should first tell the people what you're going to talk about, then you should tell them what you are talking about, and then you should repeat it the third time so that nobody misses anything. So I'm going to try to be at least coherent and tell you that from my orientation, what I really want to say to you, if I wanted to try to put it in just a paragraph, is that in the biggest planetary picture, this is all subjective, but in the biggest planetary picture, I see it as us as a species, we are being invited to stellar society. We're at least given generally the option, but we've also been given the rules. You don't go into space, take weapons with you, and if you're going to matriculate into stellar society, you're going to have to be a united, peaceful species. And when we look at the situation on the planet now and over our history, we realize that we're not in very good shape as far as unity or peacefulness is concerned. And I think that when we analyze history, that we can see that the major causes of that disunity and certainly lack of peace is what I would call, well, two things. I would call the God spell, as in the title of the play on Broadway and the title of the book that I put out back in 87 called Breaking the God Spell. The God spell is simply the my God is better than your God syndrome that keeps us slaughtering each other all this time. And the other thing, of course, is we're a primitive, maybe adolescent species at this particular point, and we're coming out of species adolescence at this point, but we have to consider ourselves as a species. We're not going to make, we have already made alien contact, there's no question about that one, but we're not going to matriculate into stellar society as a nation or a culture or even a civilization. We're going to have to be, we're going to go as a species. And the other pretty obvious obstacle to passing the SATs for stellar society is our primitive competition. And I'm confident that this will be our century of transformation. We may not make it. I mean, it's possible that we may just keep doing all the insane things to ourselves as a species, as we've been doing. And you know, the pond scum that coats the planet with a couple of billion, or about 6 billion at this particular point, members, might just be gone, might just be annihilated. We could do it ourselves. But the problem is that we also have another problem that has been kind of pushed aside, we're in denial about, and that is that the 10th planet in our solar system is, as best I can determine from all the evidence that I can gather and the authorities and sources that I can find, is on its way back in to the inner solar system. And that can actually put our species extinct. The Old Testament story of the flood, almost a children's story, repetition of the ancient, more ancient and very accurate and detailed Sumerian records, you know, would have us believe that the flood is a sort of a, it was a big tsunami that came up through the Middle East and then sort of receded, and we took a heck of a beating, but that was about it. The actual geographic and geophysical evidence says that it was at that particular passing of the 10th planet through our inner solar system, we we nearly went extinct. It can cause such upheavaling of the earth. Anyway, that's generally where I want to take us. I want to talk about where the leading edge is of our, not only our alien situation and our, but our species psychology. And I want to talk to you and with you about where the leading edge is of our actual evolution. Because all those things are just totally tied together. So I have to learn to, beautiful. These audiovisual people are really great. So let's, as Cicero says, let's do it then. What is our planetary situation? We are in an obvious mess. And it reminds me of a little story I heard just a little while ago that you probably will appreciate. It's about alien tourists. A couple of alien tourists are in their UFO and they're orbiting the Earth and they're checking the place out, and the first one says, you know, that's a really beautiful planet, but those Earth creatures have put weapons in their satellites. And the other one says, yeah, I see that. Do you think they're an intelligent, evolving species? And the first one says, you know, I don't think so. They've got them pointed at each other. And sometimes little anecdotes like that can sum up the situation quite well. Now, if I were teaching a seminar in college, I taught philosophy for a while in on the college level. I would know where everybody was oriented, what level of previous knowledge they had, and so on. And this whole, if we're going to talk about the planetary situation, we need to be able to see, include everybody here. And there's so much complex information that I'm sure that I'm going to have to cover sections so that I can try to fill everybody's needs. And that's why I have kind of broken it into like Terran politics and exopolitics. Terran politics is simply what goes on between us as human individuals and groups. I classify, for instance, the arguments that still go on about individual questions about the aliens situation, but between humans. Like, well, what do you think the alien intention and agenda is in this particular case? Well, one person says, well, you know, I'm not sure about this, and I'm not sure about that, and I think this, and the other person maybe have a completely different interpretation. But that's, in a sense, a good deal of politics between human beings. Exopolitics, I want to think and do think of exopolitics as the relationship between the human species and other alien species. But I extend it to the relationship between this alien species and that alien species, if we can attain that kind of information. And later we'll see that the further studies and of the alien situation will have to be alien sociobiology, alien psychology, androidology, and a whole realm of topics that we'll have to explore. Exopolitics is already being almost institutionalized, and it's a fascinating field that's opening up. I encourage all of you to get involved, depending on you know what your personal orientation is. And so, standstill. And I call it the illusion of standstill as far as terror and politics are concerned. And it's a, we all feel it. We feel that we're pushing against this barrier. And a lot of people say, well, you know, it's because it's the government cover-up. And yes, to a certain degree, we're looking to authority and the governments to recognize and to disclose. And you have disclosure projects and for many years, the topic of conversation in this particular conference and other conferences has been how do we get the government to disclose? But I'm going to suggest to you, I submit, that there are clues in the cover-up arena that we are maybe not paying as much attention to as we should. Not only do the militaries, obviously, and the governments and political organizations exercise a lot of heavy pressure and authority and actually suppress the information and cover it up, deny it. But we also should take into consideration what the religions do. Pat Robertson, just a little while ago, a few weeks ago, I can hear you laughing. It's like Pat Robertson said, you know, in the name of God, people who believe in aliens because they're all demons and everything, and they should be stoned. Okay. It was only just a matter of a month and a half ago, that the Vatican astronomer said that, well, you know, it's, and obviously he was not poisoned or defrocked or whatever, he was a Jesuit. So we can assume that he was at least, you know, indirectly saying what the church wants us to believe now. This is the Vatican speaking. He said that, there could be other species out there. And if there are, it's all God's creation, and therefore, there probably are brothers and sisters or, you know, of course, he didn't throw in the Jesuit theology that's been around for quite a while that says, as Monsignor Balducci held, Monsignor Balducci passed away, by the way. We have to, any species like that we have to, we come up against, we would immediately have to determine whether they were affected by original sin and needed salvation. Now, at one point in my life, I came up, born, brought up as Catholic, eventually ended up studying for the priesthood. I was even a Trappist novice for a while. And so I kind of know it from the inside. And it was like the doctrine of the creation of the world. You know, Bishop Usher's decision that when he did the arithmetic backwards in time, that the earth and all on it in 6 days must have been created in, I think it was 3014 BC, in October the 9th at 9:30 in the morning. And you know, that was heavy stuff. You wanted to watch your butt, you know, if you went up against that, until 1952, when I was in the seminary, and the rector of the seminary in this evening talk kind of broke the news to us that, well, you know, maybe that isn't doctrine so much anymore. So the standstill that I'm talking about is what we feel, you know, the frustration, the impatience, when we can see they're here. There's a whole variety of species. There many of them are very different. And we would like to get on with it. So what I would like to do then is try to give you some ideas about how we can get on with it. And as I mentioned before, one of the central focus problems here is the return of the 10th planet that could literally put us extinct, and it's being covered up. In 1983, the NASA Dutch satellite was sent up there, the IRIS, the infrared imaging satellite, specifically to look for the planet in our solar system. And they found it. They made 6 announcements in the newspaper, and as many of you no doubt know, the last one was by Ray Reynolds of JPL NASA, who was part of that team, the IRIS team, and he said in the New York Times on January the 11th, I think it was, in 1983, his final statement in the interview and the piece in the paper, he said, well, you know, astronomers are so sure of it that all that's left to do is name it. And then the shades came down. And so these are the clues that I'm pointing to in the cover-up. The interrelationship between all these different phases of denial, suppression, and cover-up. For instance, we know, and we'll later see, that there are some people here, I'm sure, who have no familiarity with the thesis of Zechariah Sitchin or Sir Lawrence Gardner, or they don't, they haven't had the opportunity to read Allen and Dallaire and Cataclysm. So we'll cover that. But to look at the interrelationships kind of preliminarily, if they tomorrow came out in the scientific community and they said, yes, there is a 10th planet there, and we did get it with the IRIS satellite, as Harrington and Sitchin, Harrington being invited Sitchin in, into an interview in his office in the Naval Observatory and in the early 90s. And he had read Sitchin's first book, at least, The 12th Planet. And he realized it was a very honest, open scientist. Here's the chief astronomer of the United States. And he said, you know, I've read your book, and I have to say that the ancient information that you're translating and quoting from, you know, like 5,000 years ago, 5 or 6,000 years ago, that was taught to us about the 10th planet is more complete even than the preliminary information that we have now. It has a huge elliptical cometary orbit once around the sun. The ancient records, of course, say it's 3,600 years once around our sun. That if this is the plane of the ecliptic where all the planets are rotating, it's tipped to that plane about 40 degrees. And it comes ripping up in, and it comes to perigee, the farthest point in the inner solar system, in between Mars and Jupiter. And so this extraordinary videotape interview that you can see, I think Jason Martell has it on xfacts.com, his website, and it's, and if you Google it for YouTube, you can just see the conversation between these two. And so he's corroborating in the early 90s. And then he comes to a point where he says, yes, as you pointed out to Sitchin, as you pointed out in your book, it is a situation where you can explain so many of the phenomena that we see that are kind of anomalous, like why Uranus is tipped over on its side by 90 degrees, and why Pluto, now it's controversy whether it should be considered a planet or not, but why that could have gotten pulled away from a major planet as its moon and put into its own independent orbit, and so on, so on, so on. And then he blows me away when I watch that interview, because then he says, and you know, I'm quite sure that it's a nice, good planet with an atmosphere that we could be comfortable in. And when I first saw that, I thought to myself, where did he get that detail from? But it must have been available already to him from the IRIS satellite information. Now, people say, well, somehow or other they have figured out for their own sake that huge cometary orbit must have a dead star out here, a brown dwarf. And that apparently is not accurate. The brown dwarf, a brown dwarf in the first place is a failed star. The surface temperature would be about 1,000 degrees average. It would not be inhabitable by any kind of humanoid. But which brings up the key idea here. That planet is the home planet of the Anunnaki. Now, when I say Anunnaki, some people will say, oh yeah, you know, we've read Sitchin, we know all about the Anunnaki as a species that whose home planet is the 10th planet, who came here 432,000 years ago and colonized our planet and eventually engineered us and genetically into existence and so on. But we'll go into detail on that. But when we're looking at these cross references as far as cover-ups are concerned, if they were to acknowledge the 10th planet today, those with any perspicacity would immediately say, well, that matches, the characteristics match the old records, and that must be the home planet of the Anunnaki, so the Anunnaki must be real, and so therefore all the information that we have been taught for a long time is mythology about the quote-unquote gods, maybe that's true, you know? And so the cat's out of the bag. But if they start the other direction, I shouldn't really get too far ahead of myself here. that's the basic problem. We have no consensual, generic definition of who we are. And that's a great deal of what is at basis of the religious conflicts. Because the Catholic doctrine, and therefore carried over into all of the myriad of, I was going to say Protestant, not just Protestant, but all of the Christian offshoots, is that we are a flawed creature who really can't, we're going to do depravity left on our own. We must be supervised by a cosmic, pretty angry God. We have no chance of evolving. We can't evolve. And we're only going to be saved if we accept a savior. Okay? On the other hand, you have the evolutionists who are saying, not just give me a break, but you know, we can see in all of the scientific evidence from paleontology, anthropology, geology, and so on, that it's more a process of Darwinian evolution. Well, I'm going to suggest to you that we do have sufficient information now to be able to resolve all of these questions. And to repeat, you know, we're, and I say this, I try to qualify this and say subjectively, this is, I can't say what I'm telling you is dogma. I'm saying this is what I have best determined for, I'm 79 going on 59, and I've been at this from the age of six or maybe before. So that's the only basis of credibility here. I'm putting this out for your consideration, in your own decisions, not only personally, but for the species. and so to try to give us some key words, talking generic humanity, not you as an individual or me as an individual, as beyond any religious affiliation, beyond any philosophical school of thought, it was pretty hard, to get yourself cleaned up for all the programming that we've received from the time that we were born. But it's good to think in terms of, well, what is a generic human? You know, what kind of definition do we have? And which brings us back to the I'm going to call it the other side of not just the cover-up, but the other side of the explanations. Zechariah Sitchin, I call him the Darwin of our day. Zechariah, good friend. He's got almost 10 years on me, but he has been at it all his life. As a young boy, in studying in the original Hebrew in school in Israel, he one day, probably 11 or 12 years old, pretty bright lad, and his teacher said to explaining the sixth chapter of Genesis, where it says, before the flood and after the flood, the sons of the gods were on the earth, and they called them the Nephilim in the Hebrew. They were on the earth, and they became enamored of the daughters of men and took unto themselves wives as many as they wanted, and had children by them. And the Hebrew teacher, who should have known better, did know better, I'm sure, said that translated the word Nephilim as giants. And this has been carried down into modern translations for a long, long time. And Sitchin, at 11 and 12, knew very well that it didn't mean that at all, and he asked his teacher, "My teacher, why do you translate this word Nephilim when it means those who were sent down and not, it doesn't mean giants at all?" And of course, the teacher gave him exactly the wrong answer. He said, "Sitchin, sit down and don't question the Bible." Well, at 11 or 12, even, he knew he wasn't questioning the Bible. He was just questioning the translation. But that's where he got his start. And he's been at it ever since. He is one of 200 on the planet Sumerian scholars who can pick up a hieroglyphic clay tablet or Sumerian tablet and read it like you and I can read the newspaper. And he's fluent in all of the Semitic languages, and he's retranslated and reinterpreted so much of this. And his basic thesis is simply that the that even though we've been taught, we were taught for a long, long time that anything, any of those so-called gods were all mythological, the projection of human psychology. That reminds me of a book that I would highly recommend. It's called The Masks of God by Joseph Campbell, a Jesuit, who wrote a comprehensive set of volumes analyzing the ancient gods. And he came to the conclusion, as he says in primitive mythology, I think it is, in the first volume, he says, look, when you study the mythologies, you take them as mythologies and you study them all over the world, there is an amazing thing that you discover, and that is that the genealogies of the gods all over the world, whether it be in India, in their traditions, or the Norwegian traditions, he said, the gods, the genealogies of the gods are all the same. They may have different names, but the relationships are all there, and you can cross-correlate them right on down the line. And so, of course, not his God. I mean, he was a Jesuit, and you know, you draw the line someplace. But that is a fascinating study, and it gives you some real clues as to, you know, what was going on back there. So. The idea here is that whereas we were taught that all of that stuff back there was mythology, Sitchin says, you know, if we look at all the information that we've got from archaeology, paleontology, history, and so on, from astronomy, from the last 150 years of recovered archaeological information and that sort of thing, then we have to say that it wasn't mythology at all, that these gods were real, they were humanoid, and the historical actions and everything they did was accurately portrayed in the ancient records from Sumeria and Babylonia and Akkadia and so on. And what does that mean? It means that when you really get down to the basic facts, they were not only humanoid, but they were alien. Well, what makes it easier for us now? Well, look at the our scientific developments. There's a story, for instance, of the flood. Well, when we look at our historical records and paleontological and geographical information, we can see that we can almost pinpoint the time of the flood someplace between 9500 BC and maybe 10,500 BC. And that's why I mentioned that book, Cataclysm by Alan Dallaire. They have documented it on a worldwide basis. They say at that particular point, and it was caused by the passing of the home planet of these Anunnaki, these gods, transcultural gods known to all the ancient civilizations, that this was not just some kind of tsunami. This particular passing, because of the geomagnetic and gravitational effects on the other planets as this thing comes whipping in once every 3,600 years, in that particular case, and apparently it depends on whether we're on this side of the sun when it comes to perigee over here, or we're on this side. If we're on this side, the effects, this may be a little bit oversimplified, but when we're close to it and exposed to that planet, which is it's three or four masses of the Earth, it's almost Uranus. It is, according to Harrington of the Naval Observatory, most likely at least Uranus size, and that's a big puppy. Alan and Dallaire have documented the fact that at the time of the flood, which is remembered in 42 of the Native American legends in this country, and it's in the legends of all the countries of all the cultures of the world. At that particular time, when there is the most cataclysmic effect, it can push up mountains, it can empty seas, it can change the it can turn the crust upside down like this. In the northern United States, starting from below the Chicago area and up into Canada, they know now that 50 feet below the surface, there is an entire forest of huge trees that are all laid down, laid over, as if the crust had turned upside down on them. And so, and other fascinating things, I don't want to take too much time on this, but I would like to impress you with some of the effects which we are possibly going to be experiencing in the rather near future. They have discovered in the top of Mount Everest, the highest, I guess it's the highest mountain in the world yet, that there are embedded clamshells in the top of the mountain. And not only are they just embedded, but they are embedded closed, which means that they got there, they were jammed there live. So, you know, I put these bits and pieces out in front of you so you can begin to bring this picture together, because the cover-ups are multiple, and obviously they don't, I say they, I don't like to talk in terms of the Illuminati or the elite or anything like that. We're doing it to ourselves. And the sooner that we recognize and admit that we as a species are in denial about certain things, that we just can't deal with some things, and we allow that part of us, the military or the governments or the so-called economic elites, or the Davos crowd, you know, the 1% of the population that meets in Davos, Switzerland once a year, that control about 41% of the money on the planet. You know, that's us. We're doing it to ourselves. And furthermore, I'm going to suggest that rather than saying, well, you know, these devolved power brokers, whoever they are, have not only learned how to beat the casino, but they've bought it and they're controlling it. I myself feel that what we're looking at is a knowledge on their part of these possible catastrophic things. And I'm saying global warming is caused by this incoming 10th planet. If you look, and on top of that, they also recognize that competition-wise, that's the end, we're at the end of that game. When you've got 6.2 billion people on this planet, and you're still playing the power games on the basis of the illusion of limited resources that you gotta compete or kill for, that game's up. And we need to go from competition to cooperation. The transition is going to be either graceful, because those with the smarts to structure it will help us and do it, or we'll go kicking and screaming. But if we're going to survive, and we're going to meet the conditions for matriculation, we're going to pass the SATs, the Standard Achievement Test, to get accepted as a species into stellar society, we're going to have to do this. And I don't think I'm too much of a Pollyanna to suggest that we're already into that tradition and transition now, not tradition, but transition, transmutation, that this will be known, this 21st century will be known as our century of transformation. Not reformation, not renaissance, but radical species transformation. Anybody, want to affirm their conviction in that way too? For those of you who are not familiar with this other side of the alien situation, we can do a bit of a summary here. That the graphic, let's see if I'm competent enough to manipulate this. Not competent. Non compos mentis. The picture on the right side of the, as you face it on your left side of the screen, is a schematic of the solar system, and this is courtesy of Jason Martell, who has some really great graphics on his xfacts.com website. And he's been very gracious to allow me to use some of his graphics. You can see that the outermost planet there is called Nibiru, N-I-B-I-R-U. I believe it says that on the, number 12, Nibiru. And that's the Sumerian for the planet of passing. And that's the home planet of the Anunnaki. And so Sitchin's thesis says, all the records tell us, and they taught us when they were here, that 432,000 years ago, they colonized this planet. They were taking huge amounts of gold out of here. He says primarily to seed the atmosphere of their planet with molecular gold, almost like a reflective heat shield, because you can, reasonably, if your planet goes out to creates the outer edge of the solar system by in a 3,600 year orbit, that its distance from the sun would seem to cause it to be a pretty cold place for humanoid existence. But he says that what they taught us was consistently mentioning their planet as a very radiant planet. So it's very possible that it has a very high internal core temperature, which would certainly mitigate the cold. And it also is a known fact that from astrophysics, that if you have a huge body that is in an elliptical orbit, and this one is an extremely long elliptical orbit, down at the bottom of the picture, you can see it drawn there, where it comes into the inner solar system and comes back out. And the astrophysics say that a body that's in an orbit like that, because it, by the nature of the astrophysics and gravitational mechanism, it is always tending to go into a circular orbit, and that causes enough tensions and geophysical effects to create warming also. And that I go into that much detail because there's a lot of people who immediately say, well, you know, if it goes out there 3,600 years or 1,800 year distance from the sun, that wouldn't it be very cold? They couldn't live there. Anyway, the ancient records say, and as Sitchin has put out, 432,000 years ago, colonized the planet, taking gold out. We have rediscovered 100,000-year-old gold mines in East Central Africa, which were obviously theirs. And to shorten this up a great deal, 200,000 years ago, they had a rebellion in their gold mines. The lower echelons, there weren't many of them here. And the lower echelons rebelled in their gold mines and said, look, we don't want to eat the dirt down here anymore. Do something. So there were two brothers who were in charge of the planet. One was named Enki, E-N-K-I. The other one was Enlil. They were half-brothers, and they were usually almost always at odds about how to treat humans and how to carry on business. So Enki, being the chief scientist, and his half-sister Ninhursag got together. They were capable 200,000 years ago of doing genetic engineering. So they took the end product of the indigenous evolutionary process here on Earth at that particular time, Homo erectus, and impinged specific animal genes on Homo erectus to try to bring it up to some kind of both physical and basic mental capacities so that they could replace their gold miners as a slave species. And it didn't quite work. They got creatures that lived, and when you go back and look at the ancient cylinder seals, you can see these creatures, which of course we always said were mythological, but really weren't, with hooves, but standing on 2 feet, or two hooves, and with semi-human faces and horns and stuff. And that was apparently a record of what they got the first time through. Didn't work. So what they did is eventually decided to take Homo erectus genes and their genes, Anunnaki genes, hominoid, and they did the genetic engineering, and here we are. So this resolves one of the major conflicts that is perennial conflicts that is in our cultures at this particular point, the creationist evolutionist conflict. And so both are half wrong and half right. There was a creation, but it wasn't by a cosmic god in 3014 or whatever, in 6 days. It was in a genetic laboratory. And they even told us that the genetic laboratory was in East Central Africa, down close to where their gold mines were. And so here we are. That means that when we're talking alien situation, we're talking about ourselves too. We're half or partly, I don't know the exact proportion. Maybe eventually when we have read out the entire human genome now, but I don't think we're in denial about the alien components. Every once in a while, there's some scientist that says, you know, there's this package of genes here in the code that, what's that? It looks like it came from the outside, or I've heard the word alien used, but we're not gonna get there very soon. So the creationist creationists are half right, half wrong. There was a creation, but it was in a genetic laboratory. The evolutionists are correct. There is obviously a natural evolutionary process that produced up to, say, Homo erectus, but from there on, it doesn't fill our development from 200,000 years ago or less, doesn't fill the criteria for Darwinian evolution of you know, like gradual mutations and so on. We're going from square one in a genetic laboratory in 200,000 to Mars with whomever can afford to go with us shortly, at least publicly. I think we're there already. You know, in 200,000 years, it took Homo erectus a million years to go from rough flake stone tools to smooth flake stone tools in the natural process of gradual mutations and evolution. So that kind of resolves one of those major conflicts, just almost incidentally. So in the upper right-hand corner of the screen, there is a picture of a cylinder seal. Cylinder seal is not very large. Usually they're about an inch in diameter or so, and about maybe 3 or 4 inches long. And they're hard stone incised in reverse, so that when you roll them like a rolling pin across a wet clay tablet, the face of a wet clay tablet, it produces a picture like that. And so what we have there is on the right side, the seated figure is one of the Anunnaki bosses, one of the CEOs, and the second figure from the right is another Anunnaki who has a human by the hand, and he's presenting him to the seated Anunnaki. And the seal is talking about the donation of more advanced agriculture to humans, they taught us. Because after a while, we were invented as a slave species, very primitive, became probably because it was the first time that the Anunnaki had done this kind of genetic engineering, we became a good deal more precocious faster than I think they anticipated. We eventually ended up to be partners with them, sexual partners, and so on. But at this particular point, they're celebrating, in this particular cylinder seal, they're celebrating the donation of advanced agriculture to humans. But the key thing is what I have circled there. In between the two, there is a star, a disk with rays coming out of it, representing our sun, and then around it arranged a series of disks in the correct sizes to duplicate every planet in our solar system, and including our and also including our moon. Now that thing is 4,500 years old. And so we're into the evidence from what we call ooparts, out of place objects in time. It's an acronym for that. And at the below that, there is a schematic detailing what is a little more difficult to see on the cylinder seal because of the photography. And I have the 10th planet, which they, of course, was their home planet, and they could tell us about that just as easily as about Mars. But I have that one in white, and it's in the proper position between size. You call these things to, you call these things to the astronomers' attention, and you say, 4,500 years old, and there's the solar system, and you get the glurg response. You know, it's like, I don't know. Now, this represents the landing grid that the Anunnaki used. They centered the point, the apex point, up on around Mount Ararat, and they drew two lines on their maps, as represented in the schematic on your left-hand side. They drew the radii out this way, and then they drew some circles in proper proportion. And you notice that there are black dots on the intersection of the radii and the circles, and that's where all the ancient cities are. And so what they did is they used their city layouts so that when they were coming in and out from the 10th planet to here, or from Mars to here, it's like flying down the ILS if you're an instrument pilot. So, in I think it was in 83 also, the mitochondrial DNA search for Eve, that was a worldwide project that was looking for the location and the genetics of the most ancient humans. And what they did is they went around the world and they took samples of the female DNA. Remember, the DNA is transmitted only by the woman. The mitochondrial DNA is transmitted from woman through the women. And so they went around the world and took samples of the mitochondrial DNA, and they analyzed them, and they found what they were looking for is the greatest number of mutations. Figuring the greatest number of mutations would indicate that particular woman or group had been around the longest for the mutations to take effect. So they discovered that the earliest human mitochondrial DNA showed up right there in mid-central Africa, and when you put your finger on the map, that's exactly the place where the Anunnaki told us their laboratory was, where they did the genetic engineering. And that cylinder seal that is represented there is Enki on the right and Ninhursag on the left, and it's a record of their celebration of successfully, it looks like almost a bassinet there, doesn't it? Creating the first human, first successful human. When you think about your own psychology, you think, what? Why do I have these various mechanisms, these various processes inside me that sometimes seem almost in conflict? And so maybe, you know, when you come right down to it, we got the best of both worlds, not to make a bad pun. The Homo erectus, our Homo erectus gene component, puts us in tune with this planet. You know, it's a nice place to live, a nice place to visit. And if we use some common sense, it would be a really great place for everybody. And the Anunnaki, our Anunnaki gene component is kind of pushing us off into space. And so not only do we have insight into our species psychology and development as we see ourselves going from slavery and submission to an alien society, but we're now coming into our own post-adolescence phase so that we can see that we can become independent. And it shows us, as we will see in a few minutes, that all of the cultural and religious institutions that we have developed are projections and sublimations and continuations of those things that we were taught as a slave species and also eventually as independent partners with the Anunnaki. A few other curiosities that there's a little bit better picture there of that cylinder seal at the bottom. But in the upper right-hand corner, this is an Inanna, who was one of the top Anunnaki elite on the planet. They lived thousands of years, and I'm not sure, and neither is Sitchin, why they had such extended lifespans. I suspect that it's because they had developed the genetics, and they also were using monatomic gold, which we'll look into a little bit later. But this is Inanna in her flying costume. She's got her visor up, but look at what's on her back. There's a square, a rectangular box with a hose coming off of it. It's probably her oxygen tube. They had rocketry, they had, and eventually, as best we can tell, by the time they phased off here, it came 432,000 years ago, when they phased off probably around 1200 BC, finally, some of them left, most of them left, some of them stayed. I think they had anti-grav by that time. And they also had androids. Oh, I'm sorry. That other curious picture over on the upper left-hand side is a frieze that's on a beam in the Abydos temple, so-called temple. And if you look closely, you can see that there are incised forms, one of which is a helicopter, another one which is looks like a jet, a couple of jets, and these are just offered as kind of a sampling of some of the evidence from Uparts. And this is probably the most colossal Upart that we know of. That block of stone weighs 1,200 tons. We have no way of quarrying, cutting, shaping, transporting, lifting a block of stone that big. You can see that people look almost like ants up on top of that thing. Visualize to get a sense of the weight of it. Think about an oversized Walmart parking lot that's full of 600 cars. Squash them all down in your mind and put them on 60 tractor trailers to take them away. An average 2 tons apiece, and you know, it's mind-boggling. But there are three of those. In the temple wall in Baalbek, what we call it a temple. There's a man standing there, and those blocks are stacked up 35 feet high above him, and obviously cut to precision and fitted into place and lifted with no problem whatsoever. But it turns out that when we go into the ancient records, Baalbek was not a temple, it was a landing platform. And so it makes sense to have stones that are that substantial if you're going to use it as a rocket blast pad, especially big rockets. But that, I believe that's 50, I believe it's almost 50 million square feet of space. It was ancient and was obviously from before the flood. It withstood the flood. And the Romans and the Greeks subsequently came and built their own temples to their version of the gods on top of it. But you know, you ask archaeologists about this and you get the glurg response. It's like, and there's a map that just shows where the Anunnaki major centers were. They started there in the Middle East, and then Inanna demanded that she be given domain over a certain area, so they gave her India. And you want to know why the most ancient gods worshipped by the Indians were female? Inanna. There's a fascinating book called When God Was a Woman by Merlin Stone, probably 20, 30 years old now, but she gives the details of why the women of India, at least at the very beginning, were treated equal with men, could own property, could do, you know, there was total equality. And in fact, the women were almost considered to be a little bit better than the local dudes, and that was the reason why it was Inanna's territory, and she trained them that way. Now over on the far side, Central America, and that brings up One of the sons of Enki, his name was Ningishida in the Sumerian, and then later in the Egyptian culture, when he was given domain there in Egypt, partly, he was known as Thoth, T-H-O-T-H. And by the time he was given full domain of his own piece of real estate and control in Central America with the Olmecs, Aztecs, Mayans, he was named Quetzalcoatl. So, which brings up the whole concept of the advanced Mayan astronomy. I may be getting out of sequence here. Well, this one just, I can finish up this sequence in the sense that if you look at the picture on your left, in 1750 BC, there's the Nephilim Anunnaki. Nephilim was another word for Anunnaki in the Old Testament, as was Anakim. It all means the same thing. But he's the Anunnaki ruler's there, and his foreman king is standing in front of him, getting his orders for the day, I suppose. Whereas a little bit later on, by 1230 BC, in the right-hand picture, the king is saying, "My lord has left me." The Anunnaki contingent went back home, most of them. What shall I tell the people? You know, he's got a problem. And we'll see later that the Anunnaki Enki, particularly, who is more benevolent to humans because he was the one who genetically engineered us in the first place, and Lil, his brother, was a pretty nasty fellow. And his attitude towards humans was always, look, we created you as a slave species, you're slaves, don't you forget it, keep your place, and we'll be fine. Whereas Enki tended to foster the human situation. And that doesn't read too well, but that says Enama Elish. And the Enama Elish is a document that has come down to us intact, taught to us by the Anunnaki, that gives the details of the entire formation of our solar system. It gives all the details about our genetic creation and so on, all the important history of their development of the planet and then eventually us. And what is very telling as far as their narration of the formation of our solar system is that early on, in maybe a billion or 2 billion years back, in the beginning of the solar system, when there were nine planets in place, the Earth was not in place. And their planet, Nibiru, the home planet, Uranus-sized, was not an indigenous planet. It wasn't a member of the solar system. It was captured gravitationally from the outside. It came, as it was captured in a very unstable trajectory, it collided with a planet that was where the asteroid belt is now. It was called Tiamat. And that was a good-sized planet, but there was an actual collision of the group of moons that was around Nibiru, the intruder planet, as it's called. When it came in, it smashed into that. I may have a... no. It smashed into that planet with its moons first, and then on another pass through, the two planets actually collided. I mean, to conceive of planetary collision is pretty mind-boggling. But it took a huge chunk out of this planet that was a native planet, in orbit in between Mars and Jupiter where the asteroid belt was. And when it did that, it shoved the remaining part of that planet into the Earth orbit. But the ancients knew about the asteroid belt, which we only rediscovered, I don't know, within a century, I think. And that's the debris field, big chunks of rock and stuff, many of which exhibit very strange characteristics, like they're way too, they have organic components that are anomalous. And it makes sense if there was a collision between planets and that's the debris field, plus the other parts of the collision scattered stuff all over, and we see it as pockmarks on the moons of some of the big planets and all over the solar system. But anyway, the Earth was recongealed into Earth as we know it now, and it dragged, it was called Kingu, K-I-N-G-U, it dragged its moon with it. And that moon, that's why our moon doesn't match up with the geophysics. It seems to have had an atmosphere. It has water on it. It has parentless lead. I don't want to get too far into the details here, but it's fascinating. They gave us in this Enuma Elish document the history of the formation of our solar system. And it's aliens all the way down, the Anunnaki teaching us. When we go back and revisit our species psychology, we can see that having been created as a slave species, we become partial partners with the Anunnaki, and then they leave. You know, they didn't even turn the lights out. So we have sublimated, I think that's the best word, we have sublimated the ancient master-slave relationship up into our social structures. And the middle paragraph, I kind of put it in just ordinary letters, I don't emphasize it, but that's one of the really key ramifications. Institutionalized religion. I'm not talking about Buddhism now or Taoism. They're not religions. They're lifestyles and philosophies of life, but they are not worshiping terrible deities that will... It reminds me of George Carlin. You ever see George Carlin's take on religion? He's pretty brutal, but he says, you know, if you really want to believe him, okay, but there's this God that says, I'm the boss, you do what I say, or else. And I got these 10 rules, and if you break any one of them and you don't repent, it's curtains. You're going to hell and you're going to burn, you're going to die and you suffer and everything, but he loves you. I can't do it. I can't do it like George Carlin. I'm just trying to make the distinction here between the natural cultural lifestyle things of yoga and tantra, the whole works over there in the East. They recognize the gods, but you know, you can obviously see Inanna's influence a good deal more human. Whereas in the Middle East and in Western culture, which formed Western culture, are these God-fearing religions that and they're slave codes. Look at the first commandment. I'm the Lord your God, you work for me, you don't go over there and work for my brothers and cousins. It's pretty clear. And if you go into the Old Testament and you go to a couple of paragraphs before where the Ten Commandments are stated, it says, if a man does any manual work around his house, cultivates his garden, or I don't know, picks up a stone. You shoot him or stone him on the Sabbath, if he does that on the Sabbath. Well, it's pretty clear. You know, if you're slaves, you give me your best shot for 6 days, and then you damn well rest. You know, so you can give me another 6 days of good labor. It's and what's really interesting is that besides scholars now understanding that the Old Testament, particularly Genesis, is a rewrite of the ancient detailed Sumerian records, very much skewed in many cases, theologically skewed, that besides recognizing that, we also know things like the Ten Commandments were supposed to have been given to Moses on Mount Sinai. And he was up there 40 days, and it got written in stone, and he brought them down and got angry and broke them and stuff. But those Ten Commandments are not some kind of divine revelation, because if you read the Egyptian Book of the Dead, which was hundreds of years, published hundreds of years before Moses, you go to stanza 125, and they're there 99.9% verbatim. We'll get to Moses in a little bit, because that's another very important point. And we've been going through a 3,000-year transition to independent species status, only now stepping out of racial adolescence to do the Ciceronian thing where I repeat it the third time. Now, here's an important point. I've been mimicking George Carlin, and it sounds like I'm making fun of religion. And this is not the case whatsoever. When we look at ourselves and our own species, psychology, we're the only game in town. You know, let's go easy on ourselves here, but let's face up to the historical and alien-related situation. Is it atheism that I'm talking about? No. Atheism is precocious garden variety sophomoric complaint that how can you say there's a God who favors this tribe over that tribe, or does all the very humanoid and pretty nasty things, and is not infinite, obviously couldn't create a universe, you know, if he had to, and that should be the focus. That is the focus of atheism. But people say, well, you know, if you're saying that religion is the sublimation and continuation of the ancient master-slave relationship, you're denying the God of the Old Testament. Well, yeah, but you know, think about it. It has nothing to do with, is there a thinkable or unthinkable something, entity, being, beyond any concept that we can have, who is the cause of reality, who could create a million universes on Wednesday afternoon and play games with them. That concept is there. I'm looking for that all the time. And maybe the place to start is the law of everything that the scientists are trying to work out. But that's not going to explain something that is beyond. So I think it's worth making that point. We're not talking atheism. What we're really talking is some very important, critical species psychology. And that was Monsignor Balducci meeting with Zechariah Sitchin at a conference, I believe it was in Italy, and they became good friends, And, you know, it was kind of a standoff. It wasn't a conflict. But Monsignor Balducci was for 5 or 6 years, I think, on Italian TV and talk shows, interview shows. And he was easing the Vatican into the most modern interpretation, which is basically almost a version of the SETI syndrome. You know, we've been dialing these frequencies and paying attention, and I don't think there's anything there, which is not even correct in that sense. But they're looking in the wrong place. I sometimes think that, you know, we read these reports that there was this uh-oh moment when one of the astronomers in SETI had picked up a signal, and he looked at it and he thought, oh wow, maybe that's it, you know? And that I can't help wondering if that wasn't some alien civilization that was orbiting the planet, like those two alien tourists I told you about, that said, hey, you want to play with this guy's head? I like to put in front of you the concept of that maybe is more adequate to describe our own situation. We've seen that the evolutionist and the creationist are both half wrong and half right. But I would like to upgrade that to the concept of real evolution. In other words, our particular unique developmental process, which has been, doesn't match the Darwinian slow mutation and situation, but it's like generic humanity, just an idea, a concept, a word that maybe more adequately describes us when we're talking about ourselves. We're going through a unique developmental process, there's no question about that. And if we see it in terms of our species psychology and evolution, I think we'll be doing ourselves some real practical favors. And I also suggest the ICE principle, kind of a maybe a little smart-ass type of idea. But I think we need to begin. We know what IQ is. You know, we test for IQ. But when we free ourselves from the restrictions of the now obviously incorrect and inadequate conceptions of ourselves that we've been carrying around as baggage for all this time, we can see that our consciousness is evolving, and our IQ is evolving. And so I'm suggesting the ICE principle as a kind of a simple term for the merging of intelligence quotient, consciousness quotient, and evolutionary quotient. And we could develop tests for that now that we have some objective standards and what a generic human should be. Previously, it's like the position that the teacher, in particularly in public schools, is in. You know that as a public school teacher, you're dealing with a varied group of backgrounds in your students. They're minors. And you know that you can't teach anything important about anything important, because you're going to end up in the vice principal or the principal's office talking to some set of parents who are accusing you of twisting their kids' heads around. And so if we can get to the point of generic human, and we can then we can begin to implement these things, and we can begin to look at the kid's genetics, because we're developing tools now where we should be able to test the kid for specific proclivities, genetic proclivities. It's like the beehive. Good friend Tim Leary, who is really the Tesla of psychology, I could tell you stories about why he was made a political prisoner and stuff. I don't think we have time. But he said, look, it's a simple thing. Genetic roles are like, look at the beehive. You've got these dudes with or ant hive. You've got these dudes out there in front with big claws and stuff. They're going to protect the thing. You've got the queen, and you've got the workers and the young, and each one has a very specific role and function. And if they don't all do their thing, the hive doesn't survive. And it's not that one role, just because the queen is producing, you know, the larva. It doesn't mean that one role is better than another. It's that the DNA, the function of the DNA is to produce so many different genetic roles so that the species prospers the most. And that's why I've always appreciated the fact that Tim Leary is the one who gave me the concept of futant, future mutant. F-U-T-A-N-T. And he says, look, you know, 1.5 to 2% of the population at any given time are futants, even if they don't know it, or they're killed or suppressed or whatever. But they're the evolutionary scouts. You know, you go out there and experience the future a little bit, and you say, you know, and you come back and you respectfully submit to the species. Hopefully, like what's the best evolutionary development that we could follow at this particular given time. Now, this is where the honey is, and as far as the scout bees are concerned. The freedom that comes with breaking the God spell and understanding ourselves in our human species psychology in those terms, the freedom that comes is exhilarating, is going to be the key to the next step, to our transformation in this century. Now, some more alien stuff. Sir Lawrence Gardner is a genealogist. He's been an art historian and critic. He's written plays. A very precocious and intelligent gentleman from England, who is also associated with the Celtic organizations. And so, he was enlisted by 30 royal families in Europe. They had an agenda in mind that I think he didn't fully realize at first. he was enlisted by 30 royal families in Europe to do extensive genealogical work. As a result, he had access, unique access, to their private archives. And after a while, he got into it to the extent where he would go to them and he'd say, look, what is this special line of kings that is through most of these royal families, and it goes way back. It's referred to, but and they said, well, did you find my great 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 grandfather? No, he said, no. What is this line of kings about? Finally, they said, well, okay, look, that's the Grail. That's the Grail bloodline. And he said, well, why is it sort of just downplayed in there? They said, that's because that was the target of the Inquisition. So it takes us all the way back. So eventually, Lawrence traced this bloodline all the way back to Sumeria and to Enki. And he said, look, when you read the original Hebrew account, it doesn't say Cain was a bad guy who slew his brother. It says Cain was superior to Abel, his brother. And he said, that was a bit of a wake-up call to me. And he said, go back now and look at the Old Testament in Genesis, where there are two stories, or two mentions of Adam and Eve. One is at the very beginning, where it talks about, and it's giving a sort of a children's story version of what the ancient record said 3,000 years before about the creation of us as a species. But the second part, he said, look what it says there. Eve goes to Adam, and she says, hey man, I've got a kid from the Lord. And instead of getting rather perturbed that she's out messing around, he says, in effect, in modern jargon, way cool. And he said, and so, you know, Lawrence begins to unthread this thing, and he realizes that Enki, the Lord, Adonai the Lord, to whom, by the way, he says, everything that was happening to the Hebrews that was good was attributed to Adonai the Lord. Well, Adonai the Lord was Enki, the one who created us and benevolent. When all bad things were happening to him, it was always Jehovah Yahweh. Okay? And that was Enlil, his brother, his half-brother. And so eventually, in order to create a monotheistic concept and make Enlil, who was the nasty one, their god, when they were in captivity, the Levite priests were in captivity in Babylon and had access to all these ancient libraries, they wanted to get out of captivity, so they knew the only way they were going to get out, this is oversimplified, but this is basically the story, that they would have to favor Enlil. But they knew that there were two of them and that there were multiple Anunnaki gods, quote unquote. So what they did is they took the term Elohim, it's plural, and used that to fuse Enlil, Adonai the Lord, and Jehovah Yahweh. And so you get one God, okay? But they slipped up in a lot of places, like as far as the plurals were concerned. You know, story of Sodom and Gomorrah, the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, or the other story where it says they're getting out of hand, let us go down there and confuse their languages, obviously for good crowd control. Well, who's us? And who's addressing us, you see? And of course, that's been pointed out by scholars over and over and over again. And this is not atheism, this is just revisiting the historical facts. But so what that second story of Adam and Eve is really about in the ancient Hebrew is that Enki wanted to create, knew that they were going to phase, the Anunnaki were going to phase off, okay? And when they phased off, he wanted to have in place a line of foremen, kings, who would take their place. But he trained them. He wanted to train them to be servants of the people. Now think about this one. Enki, and this is what that second story is about, selects a human female, fathers a child by her, Eve, and to infuse more of the Anunnaki gene code into that line of foremen kings. With the intent of making them whatever better he conceived of. And so the child's name that he fathered was Cain in the ancient records. And so etymologically, you have in the Sumerian, Gra-Al, special bloodline, And then it goes, transmutes etymologically in the word forms from Graal to Sangreal in the French, and Holy Grail. So what we have here is Sitchin producing a reinterpretation of our history on the alien basis, restoration of our history, and Sir Lawrence Gardner taking off from where Sitchin leaves off. And the two of them, I think, quite frankly, should get Nobel Prizes. People say, well, Nobel Prizes for what? Peace. we have, in this case, an explanation of the evolution of our politics. Because when they finally phased off, this bloodline moved up from Sumerian to the Egyptian. Now we know it came through the Essenes. We know this from the recovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which, by the way, all the scholars on the various religions that were involved in the interpretation and understanding of the Dead Sea Scrolls did a masterful cover-up. They produced the results of their translations and interpretations in 40 volumes that I would bet that there's no more than four people on the earth who have read it so far. I started it and forget it. In effect, because there were so many contradictions of the religions in it. And so the Essenes were a group that had the best reference I can give you is by Barbara Thiering. She's a retired theologian, actually, from Australia, and it's called Jesus the Man. And she just demolishes all of the ridiculous scholarship of denial. She's a feisty lady and brilliant. And so anyway, we have a split, psychological split. The bloodline is known, and we call them mystery schools. They weren't mystery schools. They were trained in high-tech schools, in astronomy, and just about everything. They were meant to be servants of the people, but the other, and they emulated and carried out Enki's wishes and directions and teachings. And they were meant to be benevolent kings, servants of the people. But the ones that were following Enlil's example, he was frankly badass. You know, you're slaves, don't you forget it. And if you don't do what I say, it's almost like George Carlin, you know, your history. And so the lesser evolved, let's call them, group at that particular point began to split apart. This group ended up becoming the bishops in the Hebrew tradition, becoming all the first Christians were Hebrew. It was a Hebrew movement. And they became the power players, Enlil style. The bloodline, servants of the people, benevolent, became the target of those power playing. That's what the Inquisition was all about. Now that's oversimplified. I qualify it with the caveat that this is my current best understanding of the whole situation. But I think that we can understand Western culture so much better. Take it down, you know, very close to modern times with the rise rise of Calvinism. You know, Calvinism says that your measure of salvation and divine favor is like in wealth. and so there's so many threads, you know, but if we can understand that split and the conflicts between the two, it comes all the way down to Charlemagne. Charlemagne was reluctant. He had part of the bloodline, but the Roman Church, Roman bishops wanted him to become their emperor, okay, a Roman emperor. And so, I'm pretty sure it was Charlemagne, yes. So, they go to him, two of the bishops and the current pope go to him. The bishops invite him for a walk in the garden, and the pope sneaks up behind him and puts the crown on his head. I mean, talk about yard politics. But bring it all the way down to Diana, Princess Diana, murdered, okay? There is a journalist in England who wrote Princess Diana, the hidden evidence. It turns out that the German royals who took over England didn't have the bloodline. They wanted the bloodline. They knew about it. They wanted it for true royalty. So Charles's grandmother and Diana's grandmother get together when these two kids were just born, and they said, Diana has the bloodline double through Jesus and his children and through James, his brother. So they'll marry. That will put, and the woman will put the bloodline back in the royal, in the Brits. And that's what happened. But then she took up with Jody Fayez because they, I don't think either one of them were particularly into the marriage. The kids got born, and they have it. But then they took her out. They took her, anyway. But it's there. The bloodline still exists. Its end product, so to speak, is in Prince Michael of Albany, Prince Michael of, in Scotland, Prince Michael of Albany. They wouldn't let him have a passport or a visa to even leave the country. They've kept him until just recently. okay. I think we don't have time. I'd be glad to discuss a lot of this stuff anytime with you while I'm here. I've got two more minutes. I'd like to take a few questions at the end, and I still have a few minutes. In 1900, Sir Flinders Petrie's was the most well-known and skilled archaeologist, and he was funded by the Egyptian Exploration Fund in England to explore in the Middle East. And the first page of the charter of the Egyptian Exploration Fund said that we will fund all explorations that will reinforce the Old and the New Testament. Well, it turns out that Sir Flinders Petrie finds this ruins up on top of Mount Horeb. And he investigates it, and he realizes that it's not some kind of temple or living quarters, but it's a foundry and a chemistry plant. And they find in six huge vaults, stone vaults, tons and tons of this fluffy white powder that he can't figure out what it is, and they can't analyze in England. Well, it turns out, to make a long story short, and it was dedicated to Hathor. Hathor is Ninhursag, under another name, Enki's half-sister who created us. And in that complex, there were statues of Akhenaten, Miriam, his wife, and Queen Taye, Akhenaten's mother. Well, Akhenaten was the Egyptian ruler that was shoved out of Egypt. And Gardner says that when you actually analyze the history and this situation here, you realize that Moses was not really Moses. He was Akhenaten, a Mose, an important official. And so Akhenaten goes to Mount Horeb. There was no Mount Sinai in those days, even though the Old Testament calls us that. There was no Mount Sinai in those days. And on Mount Horeb is where Akhenaten went up to learn how to become Hebrew and to fit into the Hebrew tribe. And the ultimate upart is that white powder that they discovered there. Monatomic gold. Remember this one. Monatomic gold is regular gold, as in jewelry, that has been put into the high spin state. The Meissner field goes out to the outer shell of the electron rings, and it disassociates the atomic structure, the molecular structure, and it goes into the high spin state, and the metallic gold becomes a fluffy white powder. This is what now we have the restoration of what alchemy was all about. Alchem from the Egyptian and so on. It's all about this fluffy white powder. It has extraordinary properties. It is anti-gravitic. It can, we know already that if it is inserted in the DNA structure of a cancer cell, the DNA, you put a single atom here, monatomic, single atom here, and single atom here of this white fluffy powder, which is still gold, but not a metal anymore. And it increases the bioelectric current by 100 or 1,000. And the cancer cell can totally normalize itself. No radiation, no chemistry, no chemo, nothing. It can do this. And it is meant for longevity. The Anunnaki manufactured it, and they fed it to the at least to the kings. And it's available today, and I'm ingesting it. I'm also a practicing immortal. I'm signed up for cryogenic suspension to cover my bet. Alcor.org. You take out an insurance policy for the $150,000, and you're covered from day two, in case you get wasted by a drunk on the highway. Or eventually have to book it. I think we're going to get genetic engineering that will produce more immortality. And immortality is one of the characteristics that we're going to develop as new humans. I think I'm not going to take questions because this is the end product. This is where we're going. In this century of transmutation, we're going to see paranormal powers, especially coming out with these kids who are totally underwhelmed and overqualified, walk-ins, not just aliens, but the paranormal powers coming out great. The paranormal will become normal. We will see we will get extreme longevity, if not immortality. We will go to cooperation on a planetary basis. We will pass the SATs for stellar citizenship. And I'm kind of looking forward to it. People say, well, if you're signed up for cryogenic suspension, don't you believe in immortality? Or in reincarnation? And actually, I think I do, Tibetan style, where you develop your consciousness enough so that you can manage it and restructure as you come back in, instead of, you know, haphazardly coming back in as a frog or something. I'm not into that. But I said, yes, I think that reincarnation, and that's a great thing. But I am damn tired of the diaper trip. I'm not doing that again if I can help it. And it's a selection of parents. I mean, you look at what you got there to come back in through, and you say, oh, I don't know. um, all those who are for becoming stellar citizens, taking our place in the cosmos. Thank you. We do have actually 5 minutes, 4 minutes plus, and those who have pressing questions and hopefully put them in so I can answer yes or no, please come up to the microphone.
We are doing Q&A, right?
Pardon?
You're going to do Q&A in the next five or so.
Yes.
Good.
Yeah. He needs some volume. Can we have some volume on that mic? Maybe it's not turned on. On the top, there's a switch.
On the Q&A mic?
Test 1, 2,
okay. Oh, there you go.
According to Zechariah Sitchin, the Anunnaki is also believed in the Creator.
I'm sorry?
According to Zechariah Sitchin.
Mm-hmm.
The Anunnaki's also believed in the Creator.
Yes, he did.
Okay. Now then, the greatest history book written, as far as I'm concerned, is the Holy Bible. Now, the New Testament goes to the spirituality of humanity. Zechariah Sitchin says, "Don't ask me about Jesus Christ." Why does he make that statement?
That's a really excellent question. Zechariah has set some very heavy standards for himself as far as the as far as scholarship is concerned. I've called things to his attention and he has said, "Look, I haven't investigated it myself. I haven't done the research. I hear you talking, but I'm not going to pass any opinion here." And so, to answer you, the second part of your question first, the idea is that he didn't have the information that Lawrence Gardner had. And that's why I said Lawrence Gardner took off where Sitchin leaves off. And I think that's the straight and simple answer to that part of the question. As far as my friend here brought up, the idea of Sitchin interprets some of the information that we have recorded about what the Anunnaki said as meaning that they believed in some kind of creator. And I think that that's an accurate way to put it, because he translates some of the Anunnaki language as the father of all. So in a sense, they're humanoids like us, and they're saying there's got to be some other principle here, that whether we can totally conceive of it or not, and whether it has personality or humanness, or, you know, probably not. But they were like us. We think, yeah, I would like to know what the ultimate cause and purpose of the universe or multiple universes are. Somebody else?
I'm curious about the Old Testament. That's the only place where the word term Nephilim is used.
To the best of my knowledge, that is correct.
Do you know what the original has? I think the original is in Latin, in Old Testament.
No. The Old Testament, particularly the oldest books, were written in Hebrew.
All right. The question still applies. What would the original Hebrew meaning of the word Nephilim be?
Oh, it's quite clear by the components of etymologically of the word. It simply means those who were cast down from the heavens. Yeah. And it is specific. Nephilim is as is Anakim, is a Hebrew word. Anunnaki is Sumerian.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Hi, and welcome.
Give it a pull right down. There
Thank
you go.
Fantastic speech. Two questions. Why did the Anunnaki leave?
I'm sorry?
Why did they leave?
Leave?
Yeah. Uh-huh. And the second part is, who was in control of the South Americas? Were they the benevolent kings or the slave one?
I'm sorry, I didn't get the second part. Central American?
Yeah, the South Americas.
Oh, uh-huh.
Yeah, you went into who was in control of the Central Americas, but there was another star in the South Americas.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to know which, were they the benevolent king line, or was it the slave king line, the nasty brother?
That was more of a mining community in the Andes,
yeah,
in South America.
See, yeah.
And that was like Tiwanaku,
yes,
and some of the other ones. One of the Anunnaki, I think it was also Ningishida, but don't hold me on that one. I would have to go back and check. But they realized that, they were mining gold in South Africa, and then the flood occurred, and it messed up everything. So they realized that they had an advantage from the flood. In South America, when you look at the map in the Andes, because some of the gold they could actually go along and pick up nuggets, and so that's why, for instance, many of those strange rock formations that are way up in the Andes are in stepped form. It's like what is this abstract stuff for? Well, it probably was sluice ways, where they were purifying the gold and doing that sort of stuff. Now, so yes, there was one of them or two of them that were put in charge of the Andes gold mining operation. And I'm sorry, the second part of your question was?
Why did they leave? Why did the Anunnaki
leave?
Oh,
why did they leave? Because they realized that we were becoming independent and precocious enough, and they had enough gold. In the Lost Book of Enki, one of the later books that he's Sitchin has written, he talks about them discussing leaving, and they say, well, you know, we've got enough, we've got a few shars of gold, and we've probably got enough for quite a while. A shar, by the way, was 3,600 years. So it remains to be seen. It looks maybe as if they come back this time when their planet comes around. We might have a little leverage. They might need some more gold. Thank you.
What about, oh, just quickly, what about Pumapunku? Is that a landing site?
The what?
Pumapunku, near Tiwanaku, the Pumapunku ruins?
I believe that was all Anunnaki.
Yeah, but was Pumapunku an actual landing site? Because some of the slabs up there are over 100 tons.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's
they're true. Massive.
I mean, some of the stone stuff is 600 tons, 100
yeah.
tons, whatever.
Huge.
And I think, well, I don't think it was a landing platform so much as the reason why they used heavy stones, and they also have found, archaeologists have found, that some of those stones are interlocked in 12 different faces.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like they, it's almost unbelievable the way they did that. But it turns out that technique is the maximally efficient to resist earthquakes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Niel Freer.
Thank you.
Wisdom and heart. I told you.
All right, little break now.
Good job. Thank you.
Thank you.